I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. And I won't hunger anymore.
Hey, National Park Church, here for another week of finding God's story in all stories. Really excited, as I said last week, about this series. I know that we did primarily an overview last week, just trying to set the stage for why would we do a series like this? Why would we look at Christianity's relationship with movies? Or when I use the term entertainment, what I mean by that is TV shows, other things that we gravitate towards particular stories within. Why do we seek those things out? Why do we pursue them? And then how can we think about the ways in which Christianity can health in a healthy manner intersect with those types of things? And so it was just trying to set the stage for why would we do something like this, and maybe begin to think about the ways in which Christians can do that in an effective manner. And so now we're going to spend the rest of the series each week just taking a clip from a particular film and analyzing it, looking at some of the major themes, looking at things that we can learn from it. Maybe at certain times asking the question, is that the best way to articulate something? Is that the best way to think about a particular theme? Is that the best way to think about whatever story it's trying to tell us or invite us to live into? And so that's going to be what the rest of the series is going to look like. And this week, you may say that I'm picking an easy one because the Christian themes are very overt in the film that I'm going to look at today. We're going to be looking at Les Mis, and I think it's one of the most profound depictions of mercy and grace and the way in which Christian love can radically change a person's life that has ever been told. I think it's one of the most compelling stories that has ever been told. The beauty of a story like the one we see of Jean Valjean in Les Mis is it's the kind of story that captivates the imaginations of not just those who already have a predisposition to affirm the truthfulness of Christianity, but to those who may not always think that Christianity is true. There's something deeply compelling about the transformative story of Jean Valjean. And so we're going to dive in that story today. Let's pray, and then I will introduce the clip that we'll show, and then we'll make a few observations from that. So will you join me in prayer? God, we want to watch this clip from Les Mis with your with a lens of your story. We want to filter it through your story. We want to see you manifested through the story that is told in this short clip from Les Mis. We do not want to come as passive bystanders, but we want to come actively engaged in what we are talking about this morning, because I am convinced that it is the kind of thing that can transform our lives as well. That if we're willing to enter into this, if we're willing to see you in this, that it has the potency to make us different than we are right now. So as we say, every time we come together, give us eyes to see what you want us to see and ears to hear what you want us to hear. It's in your son's name that we pray. Amen. Now, to just set the scene stage for the particular scene that we're going to watch, in Les Mis, it begins, at least the movie, I know the book, I haven't read the over 1,400-page novel. If you have, you can tell me if the plot line's drastically different. But in the movie, it begins with Jean Valjean in prison. He's in prison, and he's working hard labor because he stole a loaf of bread. But his time in prison was extended because there was multiple times in which he attempted to escape. And so he's just been done with this extremely long prison sentence. And he hates the one who put him in prison and was in charge of his hard labor, Javert. And so there, you begin to see this hatred and animosity toward the one who represents the law, the one who represents the person who's keeping him in bondage and under the oppression of prison. And you get a sense that there's a hatred to the world of, how can I get in trouble for stealing a loaf of bread because one of my family members was hungry? Like, wouldn't anybody do that? And so Jean Valjean is hardened to the world. He thinks the world is against him. He hates the world. He despises the world. He very much lives in the world, as we will see, where it is an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, that I have to do, I have to work for myself, I have to get my own because nobody's going to care for me. So there's this hardened relationship to the world. And the interesting reality about this scene is that he's sent back out into the world. He's finally released from prison, but he finds that life in the real world isn't that much easier than life in prison. He can't find a job once people know his background. He's starving. He's hungry. He can't find a place to sleep. And where we pick it up in this clip is him trying to salvage some ordinary experience in life, trying to salvage a place where he can kind of stake his place and begin afresh, but nobody will accept him. He is beaten. He is kicked out of places. He is cold. He is hungry. And we will find him there when he encounters a person who chooses to love rather than to hate him, who chooses to invite him in rather than exclude him. But that's the setup for the scene that we're going to watch. So we're going to watch this scene together. It's about a 7-minute clip. And I want you to be thinking about a couple of things, and we're going to respond to him. One, the bishop or the priest in this scene, do you find him to be weak? Do you find him to be weak? Number two, how does grace affect Jean Valjean? Is it just a nice, easy, oh, of course I want to receive it? Or is it a bit disorienting for him? And number three, I want you to be thinking, why does the response of the priest have such an impact on Jean Valjean? And I know those may be easy answers that you go, oh, well, I already know the answer to those questions, but I want you to be reflecting upon those, especially be listening to the particular lyrics that are sung in this particular scene. I should have probably given this warning. Most people know that it's a musical, but if you weren't, I know that can be shocking. I know there are a lot of people that go, I don't like musicals, I don't connect with musicals. I just encourage you, if you're at that point where you're like, oh, I don't even really want to watch this because that's not my thing, give this a chance. I've grown to like musicals more than I used to, but Les Mis was one of those that broke through for me, of making me see that the very nature of these words being sung gives them a kind of power that I think just an ordinary speech wouldn't have given them. So I think you're going to find this a very compelling scene. So I encourage you to give it a fair shake. So we're going to watch this scene, and then I'll come back and discuss it a little bit. As I said before, I think that's one of the greatest examples of grace that film or stories has ever told. Just the way in which grace can break through the most hardened heart. And I wonder, and maybe you want to pause the video and take some time, what are just your initial reflections? And since you're watching this at home, you can either answer it in your head, you can write it out, maybe you want to stop and you type it in the comments and we can create a conversation there. But what are your initial thoughts to that scene? What hits you? What strikes you? What are the things that draw you to that scene? What are the things that are your initial takeaways? And I want to name just a couple for me. The first is that question I asked you to reflect on before we watched this scene. And that is, does the bishop or the priest seem weak in this scene? And you may go, well, why would you even ask that question? What makes you even think about that? Because maybe it seems to you obvious he doesn't look weak. But I ask that question because I think, if you take it outside of the story, if we just were in everyday life, what would be one of the reasons, one of our justifications, or one of our reasons for being very, very cautious to show the kind of love to Jean Valjean or a person like Jean Valjean in our own context? And I think one of the reasons we would struggle to show the kind of love we see in the priest or the bishop is that we would be very wary of being taken advantage of. Right? So if we share too much love, if we show too much compassion, we may get taken advantage of. And we don't want to be taken advantage of. I know during our Wednesday night series when Paul Castleman and I were teaching on the Sermon on the Mount, that was a regular conversation. Well, am I going to become a doormat? If I love in this kind of way, if I show compassion in this manner, do I become a doormat? And I think what's fascinating is no one watches this scene and goes, man, the priest looks like he's getting taken advantage of. He looks like a weak person who doesn't know how to engage in the real world and he's being taken advantage of. No, when you engage with the priest, when you watch the scene, he seems like the most powerful man in the entire story. And I want to reflect on why is that the case? How is it that this priest, who for all intents and purposes is taken advantage of, he welcomes this person into his home. He gives him a bed to sleep in. He gives him food to eat. He gives him a fire to warm up in. He offers him clothes. He gives every indication that I'm willing to help you and to take care of you. He puts no extra burdens on Jean Valjean, and Jean Valjean responds by stealing from him. Is there any more indication that it seems like he's become a doormat? That his charity and his kindness and his generosity and his grace have been responded on and spitted upon by Jean Valjean? And what he should know now is that probably wasn't worth it. How many of us in that scene, if it was in the real world context, and I know that would be my case, I would go, yes, officers, he stole this from me. He stole it from me, and I try to be gracious to him, and I try to be kind to him, and I try to treat him the right way, but he stole this from me. He doesn't deserve the grace and generosity that I give. But what's fascinating in the story is the priest is so powerful, is so strong, is so in tune with the way of God that Jean Valjean's actions will not determine the way in which this priest or bishop will treat him. That's the essence of true power. Weakness, especially as we see in light of the Christian story, weakness is not being taken advantage of in the way that Jean Valjean takes advantage of the bishop or the priest. Weakness is allowing another person's actions to dictate the way that you're going to respond to them. Right? This has to take us right back to the heart of the Christian story. At the heart of the Christian story is people screaming, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him at Jesus, spitting upon him, mocking them, mocking his disciples abandoning him. And if Jesus only responds in kind, if Jesus only does to them what they deserve, if Jesus only gives them what they seem to indicate they want, because they don't want his love, they don't want his grace, they don't want his mercy, they're antagonistic towards him. If he responded to the way that they deserve to be responded to, or if their actions dictate the kind of action that Jesus is going to give them, then he would have responded in hatred. He would have responded in, well, I'll respond in violence back to you. If you're going to inflict violence on me, I'm going to inflict violence on you. But what reveals Jesus' power is in the midst of people responding in hatred and vitriol, he is so powerful that he doesn't have to respond in kind. He chooses to respond in love. I think if Christians can adopt that, and you're looking at somebody who really struggles with it, but if Christians can adopt that, we will begin to see the transforming love of Jesus change very hard hearts. Because Jean Valjean has lived in the world where everybody has responded in kind, even when people haven't recognized the extreme, unique situation, for example, of we're starving here and so I stole bread, there's been no generosity, there's been no grace, there's been no mercy, you just get what you deserve. Everybody's out for themselves. You get what you deserve. You broke the wall, so you get what you deserve. And it is only when somebody has the power not to respond in such a way that has been dictated by, well, you did this to me, so I have to do this to you. You see this in the song that Valjean sings, right? He describes the world as the eye for the eye and the tooth for a tooth. But it is one when someone chooses to step outside of that, to allow grace to break through that hardened world, that Jean Valjean doesn't know exactly what to do with it. I want to say that what we see in the bishop or the priest's response is the kind of response we see in Jesus, which is, I am so attuned with the will of God, I'm so connected with God, that I'm living in a space, I'm living in a realm that is so different than the realm of the world, where you don't have to respond in kind, but you can choose to show love and mercy and grace, even when the person you're engaging with doesn't seemingly reveal themselves as deserving it. And I think it's important for us to also look at the flip side. Isn't the story of the gospel, yes, we're going to have to do that with other people, but the story of the gospel is that God did that for you and he did that for me. That to be a Christian is to acknowledge the fact that our initiation into this community is not that we were already the bishop or the priest, but we began this journey and we continue this journey with God being the bishop and the priest in the scene who extends mercy and grace to us. Even when we push back against it, even when we said we don't want that, even when we said we don't deserve it, right? None of us is immune to, at times, with our life's actions or the way in which we respond to God, that we've never been in the situation where we were part of the crowd saying, crucify him, crucify him. Or when God's love is being poured out to us, we say, no, we don't want that. We want to do it our own way. But the good news of the gospel, right, is that God is a lot like the priest or the bishop in this story. Paul would phrase it this way, while we were still enemies. In this scene, Valjean represents, for all intents and purposes, an enemy to the priest. But in this moment, while we were still enemies, right, Paul says, Christ died for us, chose to love us, chose to not respond in kind. Likewise, in this scene, the priest has, and the bishop has every right to say, he stole from me, he doesn't deserve this, throw him back in prison. But instead, he chose mercy and kindness. One last thing on that. I heard a great connection. I was reviewing, I was in preparation for this class, and a person was talking about this scene and described it and connected it with the scene in John, the end of John chapter 7 and the beginning of John chapter 8, where the woman is caught in adultery. And basically said that Jesus' final words to that woman, when all the crowds that were going to stone her have gone away, and he asked the question, does anyone here condemn you? Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. That basically what the bishop or the priest is doing in the scene is like Jesus looking at that woman saying, Valjean, who's going to condemn you? Who's here to condemn you? No one's here to condemn you. No one's going to throw you back in prison. No one's going to take you there. I have saved your life. I'm not going to condemn you. And in light of that, and this is where he tells him to go and be a good man that God's got a claim on his life. In essence, he says, go and sin no more. I think this is important, that grace being the first word now creates an experience for the one who's encountered that grace that seems different than if the bishop or the priest would have started with, you're a sinner, you're an awful person, you deserve these things. But when he begins with a word of mercy, a word of grace, now when he says, go and sin no more, don't continue the kind of life, the hardened life, the life of thievery, but go and change and become a different person. It has a very different kind of reality for Valjean. And that leads us to our second takeaway, or at least a takeaway that I had from this, is Jean Valjean's encounter with that. I think that's the most powerful scene, is this prayer moment where Valjean is now trying to reflect upon what just happened, what does it mean, what's going to happen with me. And I think that that's a really powerful scene because it shows the richness of what often happens when we encounter grace. There's a oh my goodness, my life can't be the same, but there's also the, I want to push back against this. Because Valjean has been hardened by life. Life has come at him in unfair ways. And so there's a moment of Valjean saying, this is not fair. And, what do I do now? And life has hated me. Everybody's been against me. But how do I make sense of this person choosing to show love and mercy and grace? It's a disorienting experience. He doesn't know how to fully navigate it. He's wrestling internally of, am I going to continue this path of life where I hate and I despise and I've been so hardened that I'm cynical to the rest of the world? Or has this changed my life radically? And if you listen to the lyrics of the song, he's wrestling and battling with the disorienting nature of grace. I'm guessing you've been there. I'm guessing that there's been times where life has been so hard and so difficult, and you felt like you've been betrayed, and you've been beaten down, and you've been hurt. And yes, you encounter a moment of grace, but you're suspicious. Can this be true? Can this be real? Can this be worth giving my life to? Because, man, I don't know if I can give up my bitterness because life has been so hard. I've been hurt by life. If life has pained me to give up that hate, to give up that vitriol, to give up that thing that I'm against, is a very difficult experience. Think about it in the context of this story. Valjean has been beaten down by the law, and he feels like he had a just moment for stealing that loaf of bread. And now he's been freed from prison, but that mark on him that he was a prisoner meant that he couldn't find lodging, that he was beaten, that he was cold, that he was hungry, that no one showed any pity towards him before he encountered this bishop or priest. And when you've had that, you build up a wall of defense, you build up a posture of, how can this world be this cruel to me? And to give that up, to say I no longer am going to live in the world where my disposition is one of hate, of one of antagonism to the people I encounter, where I've been so hardened, where I just see it's every man for themselves, or it's every human being for themselves, everybody against everybody else, because no one's going to care for me. To have grace break in and change that kind of heart becomes really difficult. And I encourage you to reflect on your own life. I'm guessing there are wounds and pains from your past, bitterness that has built up, that you want it to go away, but you can't imagine life where that doesn't dominate the way you feel toward another person, or the way you feel maybe toward yourself, or the way that you feel toward a group of people, or the way you feel toward, I don't know what the scenario would be for you, but where that bitterness has been built up. And what grace comes and does is it comes to heal that. But one of the most difficult and disorienting moments of grace is that I cannot bask in grace. I cannot rest in grace. I cannot continually live in grace until I allow that grace to take away that bitterness. And you see that tension in Valjean. And then the final observation that I have that I think is really fascinating and pertinent to you and me is at the end of that scene where he's pouring out his heart. Valjean, for the story to change, has to embrace the newness of his story. Right? That final line is that Valjean, and it seems to be the Valjean who hated the world, despised the world, had been hardened by the world, he's gone and we are beginning a new story. And it's impossible to hear that, at least for me, and not hear, anyone who's in Christ is a new creation. But I think that can be the hardest move. Can you really step into the new story that God is inviting you to because of grace? Can I be honest with you? And it's an interesting, of course I can. I'm going to be honest with you and say, when I encounter a lot of people and when I encounter my life, one of the greatest hindrances in the ability to allow new creation to transform us in radical ways, talking specifically about Christians, is often a preoccupation with our past. That because we've been unable to let go of that past, because maybe it's our own sin, maybe it's something that's been done to us, but it's affected us in such a way that it marks every part of our life and we cannot get past it. That we can't actually believe that there's a new story to be told about us, that our past just grapples at us and enslaves us. Valjean is a beautiful depiction of, here is an opportunity to step into a new way of life. This priest, this bishop has extended a moment of grace and is offering you to walk in light of that grace, that become a new person, live into the new story that is in front of you. I think it would be important for us to reflect on how many of us have not been willing to step into that new story that God has offered us to step into, because we're so preoccupied with, yeah, but look at all my failures in the past. Look how terrible I've been. Look at how many times I've started and then fallen flat on my face. And I think if you understand the Christian message, what you need to understand is that God is always saying, come, new creation is offered to you. Step into that new space. That does not define you. What defines you is the love and mercy and grace of Jesus Christ. The way Paul would say that is, for example, in Romans 5, what is more definitive about you is not your participation in the fallenness of Adam. What is more fundamental about you is your participation in the justification and mercy and grace of Jesus Christ. Many of us, like Valjean, are not going to be able to live in that new life. We're not going to be able to hear the call of, I've claimed you for God, now go and sin no more, the way Jesus talks, because we cannot get past our past. And I hope what you see here is, it is in wrestling with that disorienting grace and being overwhelmed by it really is that good and it really is offered to me and I don't have to live anymore in the world of seeking out for me or being enslaved to my past or always assuming I'm marked by my identity that given to me because of all my failures back here, but that you can live in the newness of life, in the new story that God is offering you. So I hope that you've encountered this story in such a powerful way like I have, because I think it is one of the best examples of how grace can transform the hardest of hearts. But I think it's a story that you and I need to hear. That we, many of us, find ourselves, maybe not in the extreme situation that Valjean is in, but in our own lives, enslaved to something. Feeling like we can't get out of it, and it shapes all of our reality. And God keeps wanting grace to break into our lives. Wanting to have that moment where it says, you no longer have to live in this space. You can come, you can live in the world of grace and mercy and see all the doors and new opportunities that world has to offer. So I hope that you continue to reflect on the scene. If you haven't watched the movie, it is incredible. I just gave you a little sliver of it. It is a beautiful film, a beautiful story. So hope you will engage with that. Thank you for joining us this morning. Love you guys so much. Have a great day. He's at the table of the Lord.